a workshop on Bluetooth Low Energy. It's listed to run 2 hours. I'll make sure you get out of here before, get out of here early enough where you won't be at the back of the lunch line. So I'll try to get done at 22, takes questions for 10 minutes, and then maybe you can get 10 minutes to go to lunch. There's fewer people at this session than last year. There could be a lot of reasons for that. Could be that everybody who's interested in Bluetooth attended last year and decided not to attend again, although this is a different presentation. It could be that Bluetooth low energy beacons have sort of peaked on the hype curve, and we've gotten past the hype, and now we're down to people actually trying to use them. This is a workshop, which means there's user participation. I mean, in during the week, I'd say your final grade depends upon your participation, but I guess that's not going to work here. This is Bluetooth Low Energy Beacons. It'll be a technical introduction. I'll talk about, let me start with my favorite use case. This is a shot of Del Mar, California, my favorite place to visit, that I in a previous lifetime would be traveling out there maybe once a month or so. I had the routine down. I leave here at 7 local time, get to San Diego at 9 local time, and be in Del Mar by 10, and be on the beach by 10:30 or so. And the so it was dark, but the one piece of information I really wanted to know is, what are the current tide conditions in Del Mar, right? Because that's the difference between getting wet and not. And occasionally I missed on that. And this was occurring back in the days before you had smartphones, and tide tables were a little folded up sheet of paper that had the tide tables on them for the whole year, except, and you could get them at the local surf shop, except it was closed, right? Because it was 10:30. So that's what I really wanted to know when I was in Del Mar. Or stated differently, I wanted to know information related to my current context. My context was being the current time, current location, Del Mar, and my current activity, which is walking on the beach, or refer to that here as contextual information. And this is what I'd really love. This is a screenshot of my Android phone with a notification on it that has everything I really want to know. At least if I'm walking on the beach in Del Mar, right? It gives me the date to make sure that I don't have old information off the server. This was done in November, obviously, and it gives me the nearest high and low tides. So that's what beacons can do. This was actually generated by proximity with Bluetooth beacon, and I have a bunch here, and you'll configure your phones a little bit to be able to view those. So let me talk a little bit first about what Bluetooth Low Energy beacons can do. Then we'll do an exercise where you'll view beacons on your phone on either iOS or Android phones. I assume we have some iOS phones here. Yep. Do you all have Chrome installed? Good. Because this is a Google Developers Conference, and besides, in order to see Eddystone beacons on your iOS phone, you need Chrome installed, and it takes a long time. So if you want to do the demo, if you want to do the exercise, you should probably get started on getting Chrome installed. So there'll be an exercise, and then I'll talk sort of in architectural terms, broad terms, how LE beacons, Bluetooth low energy beacon systems work. And then we'll do another exercise where we'll get down and look at install an app. You will install an app and be able to view the raw frames that are broadcast by beacons and other Bluetooth low energy devices. You'll quickly learn there's a ton of BLE devices, and you can see them. Most or all iPhones are broadcasting low energy BLE announcements. Fitbit, the list goes on. A lot of people are using this technology, but I'm just going to talk about beacons, and then I'll get to a more technical part, a more technical view of how beacons and how the technologies work. I'm going to skip exercise 3 and just give you the answer because it's too hard to make it work, and then I'll conclude with some observations. Given time, I'll conclude with some observations about what I think about the current state of Bluetooth low energy beacons and where they might be headed. This is, again, Google Developers Conference, and so I'm going to focus on Google's Beacon technologies for several reasons. One is the protocol specs are freely available, unlike the iBeacon specs from Google, from Apple, which were, I believe, are still under non-disclosure. They initially were under heavy non-disclosure, and so it's kind of hard to talk about stuff that you can't talk about. And for Eddystone, there are solutions, as we'll see in the exercises. There are solutions available for both iOS and Android, and you can use either device, and you can use either smartphone operating system with Bluetooth beacons. And I mean, Eddystone is Google's approach. iOS's approach is iBeacon. The principles are the same. They use a lot of the same technology. Some of the details are different. So if you understand Eddystone, you can figure out iBeacon pretty easily. So they're small devices I have a couple other form factors here that you can, if I can find them quickly enough. So even though you can see them on the slides, there's a couple of beacons. Those are heavy-duty big beacons. These are the beacons in the picture. So I think there's a total of 8 beacons chiming in this room, at least that I have. I mean, some other people might have some. Pardon? There might be a few more. You can run beacons on your phone, and it's always interesting if you go to meetups and go into somebody's development shop to see who has beacons running, and you can sort of suspect they're doing something with beacons. So beacons are small devices. They just periodically broadcast what are called advertising messages. Periodically meaning once a second, more or less. And here's the other form factor that I have. I mean, this one has an allegedly non-replaceable battery until you cut the plastic open. This one has a hefty, is big, and nice for development because you can run it at high power and replace the batteries when they run out. So, how do these beacons work? BLE-capable moldable devices, smartphones, can receive advertising messages, and then some sort of software on your smartphone can do something. Usually it'll display something or otherwise do something. I mean, that's the general principle. These beacons are dumb. They just continuously broadcast an advertising message, and any phone in the vicinity may receive those messages and may do something. That may do something depends on software and configuration, but it may, on an Android phone, it may display a notification in your notification drawer, depending on configuration and month, in the sense that this stuff is changing. Beacons are still a moving target, but at least if you configure things right during some months, you can get a notification displayed on your lock screen, which is what you saw in the opening slides. On iOS, you can install a Chrome Today widget, which will show you approximate beacons on your Today display. Chrome on either iOS has a screen where you can bring it up and it will show beacons that it can see, that your device can see. Also, you can use beacons to launch an installed app or get a prompt, meaning Android will bring up a Google Play Store entry for the app. The beacon can prompt for the installation, prompt on the user to install a particular app. This is just a screenshot of that same notification in the notification drawer that was pulled down from the top. This is, again, same notification on the lock screen. These were taken in late November Things are a little bit different now, but we'll talk about that as we get along. And this is what an iOS user might see on the today's screen. And this is a shot of the physical web service, which I'll talk about a little bit more. But again, it's yet another way in which on Android information about nearby beacons can be displayed. And these on Android, these are notifications. The user can click on a notification and something can happen. Depending on the contents of the advertising message from the Bluetooth beacon, and depending on the information notification, a web page might be loaded, or an app might be launched, or an app might be installed. If you click on these notifications that I showed you in the past, it goes to a web page. I mean, that's where all that information came from. Is this web page, which contains more information than was available in the notification. And that's really Google's model, is that increasingly Google's model is that notifications are just there as a prompt, and if the user is interested, they will click on that prompt and get additional information. I'll talk more about this at the end when if I have time, which I think I will. But why would you want to use beacons? Well, a lot of people are asking that question, and there seems to be a thought that they might be useful, and there have been some deployments, though there aren't massive deployments. Certainly, retail was and still is excited about beacons. Retail's that's the sort of environment. Massive amounts of money run through retail in the U.S., and if you can increase your sales by a fraction of a percent, that translates into real dollars, enough to pay for a lot of beacons. Apple stores, of course, have iBeacons. If you walk into an Apple store, a number of Target stores have beacons, and if you walk in and monitor them, you can see them there. I also, as far as I can tell, even still, Target is trying to figure out what exactly to do with a beacon. I think they will tie their beacon to their app. But the original model, and this original model was that beacons would provide micro-location. They would enable the beacon owner to figure out where exactly you were in the store. And if you were, for example, near the shoe aisle, maybe you would get it would display a coupon on for shoes. Or if you were near smartphones or smartphone displays, that you might get notifications about smartphone plans. Now, the challenge that has sort of been faced by beacons in general is that if you walk through the Target store and every few feet you get another notification, you're going to turn off notifications. And that has really been the tension with beacons, is how do I, as a beacon owner, make sure that I deliver some information to nearby smartphones, and conversely, as a smartphone owner, how can I make sure that I not be inundated with spam? Tons of beacons that I'm not interested in, and there are some approaches to that, but I don't think anybody really understands how to solve that challenge yet. Some of the other models for beacons is that you'd use them in museums. You'd walk by, and as you got near a particular exhibit, the beacon would be visible on your smartphone. Your smartphone would figure out which exhibit that was and display information about that exhibit. Or vending machines, the same sort of thing. As you got close to the vending machine, that your smartphone would display something about the vending, do something about the vending machine, and maybe bring up an app that would allow you to interact with that vending machine and buy something. Oh, so let's do the first in-class exercise. And you need, I assume you all have smartphones. Some of them might be iOS, even though this is an Android developers conference. You need a BLE capable device. We'll find out shortly, but I assume that all smartphones in this room are BLE capable, that they've been BLE capable for several years now. And you need the Chrome browser. See the handout for details. Okay, there's no handout. I didn't print copies, but I will bring it up here somewhere. So there's two sides to this sheet of paper. One for Android and one for iOS. There are some people with Android phones here, right? Yes? No?
Yes.
Okay. Then I'll good. Like I say, this is the Google Developers Conference. I'll march through this. I'll march through this once and then come back and then do the Android, then do the iOS, and then come back and do it again. So there are actually a bunch of different ways on Android where you can receive Eddystone beacons. The first set of instructions will use your Chrome browser to view nearby beacons. And you need Bluetooth and location enabled. And Google, I forget the number, the percentage of Android, I mean, because Google knows, right? The percentage of Android phones that have Bluetooth enabled is really high. I think well over half. The percentage of Android phones that have location involved, Google won't say, except to say, I think it's well over half or some number like that. You need, in order for all this stuff to work, you need both Bluetooth and location enabled. And go to settings and enable them if there aren't already. And then, start Chrome. And go to the, tap on the settings symbol on the Chrome bar, and then scroll down and you'll find a physical web entry, and you can set physical web to on, and it will give you a little bit of a message about what's going on there, and then tap on see what's by, and you should see something. I mean, because there's a bunch of beacons here. Apparently not all mine, but at least you should be able to see mine. And you should be able to see something like this. So does that make sense? I'll run through it again after I do the Android. And then, if you have a recent Android phone, and depending on the vendor, and probably on the carrier, and some other stuff like that, there may be a nearby settings in your settings. If you go to settings and Google the nearby, you may be able to enable nearby there and get some more information. We'll come back to that earlier, but Chrome at least should work everywhere. So has anybody with an Android phone seen beacons with Chrome yet?
Yep.
Or tried it and it doesn't work? Let me walk through the iOS stuff. iOS is more temperamental. It also uses Chrome because Google has less control over iOS, of course. But you need to have Bluetooth enabled. Go to settings and enable Bluetooth. You need to install Chrome, and I hope you did that already because it's a big download. And I won't wait for it to download if it hasn't already. And then you need to add a Chrome widget. To add a Chrome widget, swipe down for the notification drawer, swipe left for the today view, and you should get something that looks like this. And then there should be an edit button. And click edit, and then select Chrome under more widgets and tap done. And you will get installed if you do this right, and if this rather temperamental approach works, you should get a Chrome widget there. And then you should probably get back out of the today screen because helps if you restart the today view. So navigate to the today view again, find the Chrome widget. There's some bugs that if this is too far down, it doesn't work right. And so if you can't find the Chrome widget and you can't see the whole thing, collapse some of these other widgets up here. Maybe it's been fixed by now, but there was a bug where that didn't work too well. And there should be a show more. Button on this widget if you scroll down far enough. And if you tap OK, then it should it should work. So any of you iOS people, have you gotten your iOS phone to, and you can actually see something?
Yep.
Good. Should I run through both the Android and iOS stuff again? I'm always amazed that this works, but I did this presentation in, has it not worked for anybody who's trying?
I'll figure it out.
Okay, I'm gonna charge ahead then. I did this presentation for 55 people at the Embedded Systems Conference in San Jose in early December. And at least nobody admitted to not, everybody claimed that it worked. I was a little bit astounded. So anyway, let me recap. So on both iOS and Android, you can use Chrome to find nearby beacons. On recent Android, there's also a nearby service which you can enable by going to the settings and then Google and then nearby and enable it. And there's a third way. There's actually a physical web app that you can also use. Okay, good. I think that was successful, or at least I'll declare victory. No one seems to be complaining. I'm going to charge ahead. But I think a couple of lessons to take away from that are all your phones, particularly those with Chrome, all your phones can see beacons, but not really easily. They can see beacons, but you have to tinker with your phone. And so unless you go hunting for beacons, you won't really see them. And that's part of the challenge of beacons, of course, is that in order for you to communicate, you as a beacon owner, to communicate with people with smartphones, you have to explain to them how to enable, at least today, you have to explain to them how to enable beacons. So let me talk in sort of broad terms how these beacons work. So beacons can trigger some sort of activity when smartphones are in proximity to the beacon. The beacon send repeatedly every second, every 900 milliseconds, send what's called a Bluetooth low energy advertising message. And that contains a little bit of information. And the devices make, depending on configuration of software, may process that BLE advertising messages. And usually, these beacons will, or rather, the smartphone will retrieve additional information from the internet. And then it may do something, like generate those notifications. So, I mean, this is the general model, is that this beacon announces a little bit of information. It announces a URL, essentially. And then the smartphone goes off and goes to that URL, gets some data, summarizes it, and then displays it on the mobile device. That's in abstract what happens. What really happens, I'll talk about more in a little bit. And Google has two beacon-related services. I guess I call these beacon-related models rather than beacon-related services. And it's my feeling, my suspicion as an outsider, that there's two separate groups in Google that are advocating these different models. And you know, ultimately, they have to produce code. But I think that as we'll see in the following slides, there's a little bit different models and a little bit different views as how things work. But I think the nearby people are winning, as we'll see in a moment. So the physical web model, I think, was really the first model that Google had. And the physical web model associates URLs with objects. In other words, it makes them smart objects. And so the piece of information here is a URL, web address, that is associated with an object. In other words, the object that beacon is associated with or glued to. And so the announcements under the physical web model, the advertising messages, contain a URL. The nearby model, which I think is more recent, or rather I should say, The nearby model has been around for a little bit, but it's more recently adopted or taken over beacons. The nearby model is that there's information associated with a location, and they're really focused on location, and that beacon is an evidence of that you're in a particular, you're near a particular location. But that what it associates with is a bunch of JSON. There's a lot of flexibility in what could be in that JSON, and it's not necessarily a URL. It could just be a big blob of data. And so with nearby, these advertising messages contain a UUID that points to this JSON data. And that, like I said, that JSON data may have a URL, but it could have other stuff in it too. It's if you will, powerful and flexible. And if you can figure out how to make it work, you can do a lot of stuff with it. I'll come back to that in a little more detail. But now let me talk about beacon technologies. And I'll talk about Bluetooth Low Energy. Now, I assume you're all software people, but a little bit of hardware understanding probably doesn't hurt you, and it's probably all the more hardware understanding you need. It will give you a sense, I think a better sense of how these things work, and if you have to actually do low-level Bluetooth programming on Android, it will be useful to understand what this stuff is doing. I'll then talk about the advertising protocols, both the Bluetooth low energy protocol and the Google Eddystone protocol. Oh, and by the way, if you look on the it's not the marketing blurb, but the Eddystone usage, Google says don't call it Google Eddystone, call it Eddystone. And I think that that you can see that there's an effort to, well, there's Google wants Eddystone to be the universal beacon technology. Of course, so do a lot of other people. I don't think Apple wants iBeacon to be the universal beacon technology. I think they want iPhones to be the universal smartphone technology. And so they're not going to do much to support iBeacon on Android systems. Oh, and then I'll talk about beacon system architectures. So, if nothing else, you should understand that Bluetooth Low Energy is not the same as Bluetooth. It's a completely different protocol. I guess Bluetooth special interest group has started to use the term classic Bluetooth, but I just used that originally I had to call it something. And the classic Bluetooth is actually, if you look at the specs, is called Bluetooth Basic Rate Enhanced Data Rate. But anyway, classic Bluetooth. What you all thought was Bluetooth, you know, that your headphones use and a bunch of other stuff uses, is completely different than Bluetooth Low Energy. They're not compatible. They're different. Everything's different. For a while, it had the Bluetooth Low Energy had the marketing name or whatnot, marketing designation of Bluetooth Smart. I don't know if that term is still heavily used, but you'll see on you open your smartphone package and it might say Bluetooth Smart Ready or something like that. So. Bluetooth Low Energy, Bluetooth Smart terms are pretty interchangeable. And the BLE, Bluetooth Low Energy, was merged into the Bluetooth 4.0 spec. And so sometimes if your phone says it's Bluetooth 4.0 compatible, it probably works with Bluetooth Low Energy, but you know, the people who write those packages aren't always the technical people. Some radio chips support, particularly newer radio chips support both Bluetooth Classic and BLE, but older chips supported Bluetooth Classic and didn't support BLE. But like I say, I assume that everybody's phone here is new enough that they all support BLE now. And BLE is much slower and much lower throughput than the Classic. Bluetooth Low Energy, like everything else, including the kitchen sink, well. Maybe your kitchen sink isn't wired yet, but your refrigerator is. Everything uses the 2.4 gigahertz ISM band. I mean, that's Wi-Fi and Bluetooth Low Energy and some cordless phones and some baby monitors. There's a ton of stuff there. It has a 1 megabit per second on the air bit rate, clock rate, but it has advertises an application throughput of 270 kilobits per second. It has a range of approximately 100 meters. I think that's the only thing that's that 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 that's that that the standards makers know how to say is 100 meters, because everything has a range of 100 meters. That's a nominal range of 100 meters. Every beacon I've seen allows you to set its power level. And so you can set it at high power, or medium power, or low power. And so if you set it at high power, you might get 100 meters. If you set it at low power, you'll get substantially less. And it's designed to, its whole intent was to use less energy than Bluetooth Classic. And I'm not an electrical engineer, but I think they do that by much simpler modulation techniques and a bunch of other techniques. But consult your local EE to get more detail on why it requires less energy. And if you look on the Bluetooth Special Interest Group website, they'll say it's good for longer range intermittent communication such as Internet of Things. I think this was sort of revisionist history in the sense that Internet of Things was not a hot topic when Bluetooth low energy was developed. But there is protocols for home automation is a different talk. But if you go to that talk, or if I give that talk, there's a bunch of protocols that are competing for dominance in the home automation market. Certainly, Wi-Fi is a contender, but it's complex, heavyweight, uses a lot of power, and if you have a battery-powered device, it's not going to have as good a battery life as if you use some of these other protocols. Of course, there's a lot of smart engineers around, and they say, well, we can make a low-power Wi-Fi, and then that will be a contender. Bluetooth low energy is a contender because all your phones have Bluetooth, right? Except if I'm 100 miles away from my home, the fact that my phone does Bluetooth doesn't do me any good when I have a 100 meter range. Something called IEEE 802.15.4. I actually think is a contender. And if you look at the specs for some of the Google Home devices, they actually support 802.15.4. And at one point, I said that that 802.15.4 and Google's Thread would dominate Nest's Thread actually was Nest Thread's protocol would dominate because they had Google and Nest behind them, but I think in subsequent months it has been evident that Nest is kind of confused, and so maybe they aren't going to make Thread at 802.15.4 dominate. But and Zigbee is 802.15.4, and a bunch of other, and there's some other contenders. That's just a digression. There is a view that Bluetooth will become the home automation protocol. I think that's not going to happen in any big way. Bluetooth low energy specs are available. They're freely available online. They're not for the faint of heart. I think the main spec is 2,700 pages. And then there's a whole bunch of addendums and stuff like that. Now, a lot of that stuff is low level electrical stuff and so forth. But anyway, the spec is there if you ever want to read it. And if you're doing low level BLE programming, you probably ought to look at a few sections. You don't have to memorize this. You can come look at my presentation later. But there's the core spec, the 2,700 page document. Well, you go to volume 6, and that has a whole bunch of stuff. And then there's these other documents, CSS. The supplement, the addendum, assigned numbers. This information is information relevant to Bluetooth low energy beacons is just scattered all over. But with persistence and maybe a little bit of guide, you can find it. So let me talk about the packets themselves. About the raw messages that these Bluetooth beacons are advertising. This is a link layer. They call it the link layer, a Bluetooth link layer packet format. You've got a preamble that just allows the receiver to know that a packet's coming, you got an access address, which I'll talk about in a bit. You have a PDU, protocol data unit, for those of you who don't do protocol specs for a living, and a CRC, cyclical redundancy check, just 3 bytes to ensure the integrity, to ensure that you received this whole packet without errors. There's two channels. There's two classes of channels in Bluetooth low energy. One is an advertising channel, and the other is a data channel. Beacons use the advertising channel. Other stuff uses the data channel. I'm not gonna talk about the data channel here. I'm just gonna talk about the advertising channel. The data channel is an advanced course, but you can use the data channel to connect to the beacon and manage the beacon and do stuff like that. But like I say, I only have a little bit of time here, so I'm only gonna talk about the advertising function of beacons. So, advertising channel, that's what beacons use. It has a preamble of alternating ones and zeros in order to, again, talk to your local double E about why that's neat. But the receiver needs to know that a packet's coming and needs to know where the bits are and where the bytes are and so forth. And then if that 4-byte address is that value, it means it's a advertising frame. If it's anything else, sort of random, a 32-bit value, then it's something or other else, and it's one of these two preambles, depending on the high-order bit of this address here. But it's not entirely random. Please don't randomly pick this address because bad things will happen or confusion will ensue. And there's a whole bunch of other constraints about one densities and all the stuff that double E's care about. So this isn't entirely a random value, but it's anything else that has a bunch of constraints that isn't this value. So in short, this is what advertising beacons use this address, this preamble, the advertising channel, and there's another channel that is used for everything else. Oh, did I say that the advertising channel, there are actually, is it 40 channels? Bluetooth defines 40 channels. There's three frequencies that are advertising channels. There are 37 that are for data. And beacons are supposed to advertise on all of the active advertising channels, which means that same information is supposed to be transmitted on three different channels. So we have preamble, access address, that 4-byte address that indicates it's a beacon, and then we have the PDU, and the advertising PDU is one type of PDU, protocol data unit, that fits within that payload. Advertising has 2-byte header and a payload, so even though this PDU can be up to 257 bytes and for Bluetooth low energy, the advertising PDU, one particular type of message, can only have up to a payload of up to 37 bytes. So there's not very much room there. And if you have a really long URL, it's not going to fit. But we'll get to that. The header, 2-byte header, go read the spec. There's only two fields that are really interesting. There's 4 bits of type field. There's a length field of 6 bits long. And the reserved and transmit and receive address mean something depending upon the type code. So here's the PDU type code. The only one that's the beacons mostly use this one, a non-connectable undirected advertising. It means they're just blasting out advertisings and not paying any attention to whether anybody's listening or responding. Within that payload, there's 6 bytes of advertising address, 31 bytes of data. So again, we're down to 31 bytes of data left over for data. Advertising address, I think the spec calls it a device address. It's what you'd colloquially call an Ethernet address. It could be a 48-bit MAC address that you got assigned from the IEEE, just like all your Ethernet interfaces and every other interface has. Or it could be sort of some random device address that's not necessarily globally unique. Read the spec for the details on that. The important part is that this is the address of the beacon. It's a MAC layer address of the beacon. So this payload and the advertising frame, 37 bytes, 6 bytes get sucked up by address, that leaves 31 bytes left for advertising data. The format of advertising data is specified to be these TLV tuples, where they have a length type length value tuples. Length is the number of bytes in the value. The type code is a type code, and the value is whatever is associated with that type code. So there's a data within that advertising data. There is a structure that is enables the receiver to parse it fairly easily. And of course, you know, the length field and the type field and the value field are all defined in separate documents, just to, I don't know, make life easy. So now we have the Bluetooth packet within the PDU. There's that advertising PDU, 2-byte header, 6-byte MAC address, 31 bytes left over. This is where the beacon, this is where Eddystone message finally resides. So you get through all that overhead, we finally get to Eddystone messages. Eddystone frames also have a TLV type structure. There's a TLV type structure with a bit of a byte of flags, 16-bit service UUID, and then you have this space left over for your URL or UUID or something else. Flags, go read the spec. There's some flags there. They don't really make too much difference to the operation of the beacon. 16-bit UUIDs, there's a whole big long list of UUIDs, universally unique identifiers that are assigned by the Bluetooth special interest group. Google Eddystone beacons will use this UUID, FEAA. Google has a bunch of other UUIDs for who knows what reason. Apple has even more, I don't know, 12 or 16 UUIDs that are there for some reasons. But they are unique IDs. They're assigned to vendors, and vendors can use them, I guess, how they want. If you're using Eddystone, either use that value or you will see that value. So now here's what an Eddystone frame looks like, right? We've descended down through all those layers of packet definition, and there's another set of flags. These are Eddystone flags. There's another 16-bit UUID, and then there's the Eddystone data, finally. This 16-bit UUID is the same UUID as we saw earlier in the packet. I think the reason for that, I'm not 100% sure, I think the reason of that is that this was necessary at the time to make it work with iOS. That's all I know. Maybe it sounds like somebody may know something different. So you don't have much data, you don't have much space to use to begin with, and you end up sucking up 4 bytes twice in order to have the redundant UID. And then finally, there's the Eddystone data. Eddystone data has, again, the service, the UID, the frame type. This is Eddystone frame type, ranging data, and then the data. Let me talk about it now. And then we'll do the next exercise. And you can really look at these things. So frame type, we'll see a little bit more of. Ranging data is the transmit power of the beacon. Beacon software tries to figure out how far away that beacon is, and it's within an order of magnitude, maybe. It's not very accurate. The way it figures out how far away that beacon is this ranging data gives you the transmit power of the beacon. The beacon's telling the receiver, this is what my transmit power is. The beacon will have the Bluetooth driver will provide RSSI, receive strength signal indicator, and so you can sort of do some subtract and some math and some guesstimate and see how much the power has diminished between you and the beacon, and maybe that is related to distance. It's related to a whole bunch of other things too, like maybe which way you turn the beacon and maybe whether the beacon is hiding, but if the beacon's hiding behind a steel bookcase, well, then it's gonna act like it's really far away. But it's still, it's there, and it's a guess. Oh, so now, for those of you who are interested, and if you're still here, you're probably interested, you can, the next exercise is to install an app where you can actually receive raw Bluetooth low energy frames. I think all these devices work. What I would recommend is you go to the Apple Store or Google Play Store and look for NRF Connect. It's the nicest app for looking at raw Bluetooth LED beacons. It's written by Nordic Semiconductor, the people who make one of the popular Bluetooth low energy chips. So the idea is install NRF Connect, search for nearby beacons, and then let's look at the raw beacon. Has anybody downloaded it yet? Okay, so you'll fire it up. You'll get these splash screens. You can read them or not. And then you'll get down to a screen that looks like this, and then there'll be a button here that says scan. You'll scan, and you'll see a ton of devices in this room. Like I say, I have 8 physical beacons. It sounds like there may be some other beacons. Some of these beacons are actually looking like both Eddystone and iBeacon beacons, and so we're up to, I don't know how many beacons. But you can then look for either the beacons that say Estimote, Est is Estimote, or say physical web beacon, and you can click on those and get additional information. You'll get all this parsed information if you click on one of those that says Eddystone. Well, if you click on either an Est or a Eddystone beacon, you will get an Eddystone beacon rather than, you know, whatever your iPhone. And then down here there's a raw button. You can click raw, and there it gives you the raw data. Right? Here's the length of two. Here's some flags, the Bluetooth flags. Here's the UUID, and here's the Eddystone frame starting with a UUID of AAFE. And then there's some other information here that's another story. That's also in the advanced course. So people have been able to see. Boy, this is a pretty good audience. I mean, pretty capable audience. Either that or people aren't admitting that nothing works. At least some of it works. And I always feel lucky when a demo at least mostly works. Like I say, there's a ton of Bluetooth devices in this room. Some of them are Eddystone beacons, and they'll match up with what this presentation is. Makes sense. Small crowd. I'll get done. Since you're doing so well, I'll get done early. It took me longer to get through that demo last time around. So again, here's just a sample Eddystone advertising frame. This is defined by the Bluetooth spec, length of two. It says it's flags. And 06 means something. That, go look it up. And 03, I forget what 03 actually says it is, but what it is the UUID, and then here is, I forget the name, it's some sort of user data. We'll get service data. Service data, yeah.
The 3 is a complete list of services.
Yeah. And here's the UUID. 10 is the Eddystone frame type. DF is the transmit power, basically. It's a hash of the function of the transmit power. And the rest of this is a URL. Advertising flags, look them up as to what they are. Bluetooth 16-bit member UUID for Google. Yeah, Bluetooth data service type, Eddystone frame, ranging data. Type codes, frame, so, whoops. Eddystone frame type, there's four that are currently defined. We're using the one that's web address, is what this demonstration are. There's several others. Another is a UUID, which is a, that's just a string that can be considered a pointer into the nearby database, and that's where that nearby database will return a whole bunch of JSON data. Eddystone telemetry, we'll talk about that in a moment, but you can actually, every now and then, every few frames, Eddystone beacons will give you a telemetry frame that tell you about the health of the beacon. And then, you know, one of my use cases is, again, go back to Target, you've got the shoe aisle, and you got a beacon that's announcing advertisements for shoes. Well, you know, there's nothing to prevent someone from walking in and surreptitiously sticking another beacon in there that says, here, you can get these shoes cheaper at Amazon. And so, right? Because a beacon's a beacon, this encrypted ID is in response to that, you'd like to have some privacy, some security if you're populating beacons throughout your store. But web address is the one that we're looking at now, and so this is a compressed URL. The first byte is what they call URL prefix scheme. So it compresses http://www, et cetera, into one byte. The simple answer is, if you're doing Eddystone, always use HTTPS. Right, again, this is again sort of evidence of these separate groups within Google, right? The Eddystone people, which were the physical web people, said, okay, we can compress all four of these URLs, both HTTP and HTTPS. The nearby people, the Chrome people, said, we want to secure the web, and so we're just going to ignore anything that is not HTTPS. And so if you use a HTTP URL, Chrome will ignore it, Google will ignore it. I mean, there are ways to see it, but by and large, it will be ignored. And you just have to know that, I guess. Or trial and error or something. Compressed URL. Oh, and so, the rest of this URL is, in this case, is incontext.us. There is also a compression which I couldn't use because it was a .us domain. There's compression. You can compress .com, .edu, .net, and a few other things into one byte, just not .us. So there's another little bit of compression here. The other approach is to use a URL shortener, and Google will expand that URL shortener. The short URL does not need to be SSL, use SSL, but the expanded, the target URL needs to be. So you could put in a bit.ly or this, that, or the other thing here in order to make it fit. Example two, a telemetry frame. Again, all this other stuff is the same. We have a telemetry protocol version. Oh, I'm sorry. First of all, this indicates it's a telemetry frame. There's a telemetry protocol version number within that, and the rest is telemetry stuff. And if you look at the Eddystone spec and parse everything, you will see that Eddystone includes battery voltage in millivolts, so you can, getting that information from the smartphone back to you, the beacon owner, is another task. But you can at least the beacon is announcing its battery voltage, and so if this thing's getting ready to die, you'll know. It announces its temperature. I don't know why, other than every chip these days has a thermometer, and so I guess it's may as well put it in there. And it's in binary floating point. If you ever need to decode it, go look it up. But what that translated to in this instance was 64 degrees centigrade. So this thing was running pretty hot. I don't know why. It announces the number of advertising PDUs that it has transmitted since it was last powered up or reset or something. That does get reset now and then, but not. It gets reset if you do something, like download news microcode, or I think you can reset it in some other management tasks. And it gives you an uptime in tenths of a second, I think. Yeah, and so you can. This beacon is configured to announce at I think 950 milliseconds, and you can divide this out, and it comes to 800 milliseconds. I don't know why it's not quite exact, but it comes pretty close. So. Anyway, so you can have that telemetry frame. I think every Eddystone beacons, every dozen or so, I forget, advertising frames with a URL, they will put in a telemetry frame so that if you wait long enough, you can get some sense as to what your beacon is doing, what shape it's in. So we've got a compressed URL. And believe me, that really says ncontext.us/CA01, I think. Yeah, if you're quick enough at reading ASCII. So how does this compressed URL get translated into all that information in notification? And if you decode the ASCII, or if you just know what that translates to is HTTP, and it should say HTTPS, otherwise this won't work. It really does say HTTPS www.ncontext.us/CA01. And we already saw that if you go to ncontext.us, you get that page with a whole bunch of information about tide time. So that's sort of a hint as to how it works. But what really happens is if you look at the raw HTML for that web page, it has in the metadata, the header, it has a field that is this content. And that content matches up with that. Well, sort of. Never mind that this says Saturday, that says Monday, but you get the idea. In principle, if these things were done at the same time, they would be the same stuff. It has a this has a pointer to an icon. If you actually really, really do look at the source of this page, it's a dozen different icons for different formats and stuff, but that didn't fit on the page and it's not relevant. Let's just pretend it's just one icon. Anyway, this link has this metadata has a pointer to the icon to be displayed, and then it has additional information. It has a title. Which is this sort of primary information here. This is generated by Android at the time it generated a notification. So that's how a compressed URL is translated into a notification. Some software goes off and reads the website. So in principle, as I had this message before, the BLE beacon advertises the URL, the mobile device goes off, talks to ncontext.us and gets information. In principle, that works. That's not really how it works. The way it really works is BLE advertising message is received by the smartphone. It goes off and talks to the Google Web's physical web service. And it's a real physical web service. It's a real thing out there, a real server out there. And it passes some information about what it received from this beacon. And the web service then returns a bunch of data. At some point, this physical web service server went and talked to ncontext.us. I suspect if it never had never seen, if this beacon were brand new and the physical web service had never seen ncontext.us, it would have to go query it before it returned an answer. However, once it's seen ncontext.us, it keeps querying that incontext.us server now and again. If you dig through your web server logs, you will see that there's a couple of services from Google that are scanning your incontext.us. One is the physical web service. One looks like the address. One looks like, based on the addresses, looks like the physical web service. One is just the normal Google web crawling stuff. But anyway, so that's what really happens is that this physical web service has a cache of, all beacons in the country. So you can see, yet again, I mean, Google just consumes archives, keeps track of just everything, including where every Eddystone beacon is in the US and what mobile devices have seen it. I don't know why, except Google, I think, just psychologically can't throw anything away once they've collected. I think they just keep, I mean, I don't think they throw data away, they just keep buying more and more disks. But we'll see a little bit how this is used in a moment. So this is just a summary. Mobile device receives an Eddystone URL frame. The mobile device issues, it's an HTTP post request with some information about the beacon in JSON data to the Google physical web service. There's actually, you can dig through the, if you're really interested in beacons, you should have the physical web app and the sources available for at least an older version. And you dig through the source and you can see that there's a couple of different physical web service servers, a production and something or other. The mobile device issues an HTTP post with some JSON data to Google physical web service. The physical web service returns JSON data that was previously scanned from its database. That was previously scanned from the website. And then the mobile device creates a notification. We're not going to do this exercise because it's too hard to make it work. I mean, I got through two exercises and they seem to work. I'm not going to push my luck because I know this one won't work. But you could, in theory, if the app does it right, so you can do it. So you could, if you work hard enough, you can send a post request with a browser plugin, post request to the Google physical web service, and then you could look at the JSON that's returned by the physical web server and stick it into a prettifier and actually look at it. Instead, I've just done that for you. So this is information that was returned by the physical web service. It's a blob of JSON. It was returned by the physical web service to a smartphone that was nearby one of my beacons. And this first, it runs over several pages. The first is, it just has a device address. I don't know what these are. I might have known once, or could figure out from the code, but Google tracks everything. It has the device address, the MAC address, the receive signal strength indicator as seen by the device and has the transmit power, which is some function of that byte that says it was the ranging data. The next chunk is, again, URL metadata. I don't know the difference between a site URL and display URL and ID. Maybe the SEO people know what they are, or you could dig through the code and find out what they are. But Google, nonetheless, has in its physical web service database, has three spots for URL. They're all the same here because I sure don't know how to make them any different. It has a title, which is that title out of the header metadata, has a description, which again was out of that title metadata, and then it has an icon. It has, right, and so this is the whole URL. So it also, Google also caches the URL. caches the icon, and it gives you the icon. There's another 8,000 characters that I deleted here. So that they're really boring. So that physical web server caches the icon and delivers the smartphone the icon in this JSON data. And then down at the bottom here, we have rank. Again, this is Google, right? They never throw any data away, and they rank everything. And there's a lot behind that ranking. Google will be more likely to generate notifications for highly ranked beacons than for lower ranked beacons. So how do you have you get a low ranking if people see your beacon and then dismiss it. You get a higher ranking if people see your beacon and click on it. And who knows what else occurs. But there is a ranking. It's used by Google. I'm sure it's like everything else. They're still tinkering with it. But it means that, first of all, not all beacons are going to be displayed. And I assume there's going to be a whole business of SEO, SEO something services to increase your ranking of beacons. But it's there. I don't know. And Lord only knows why it needs that many significant digits. But I assume it's just a number rather than having some significance to those digits. Anyway, the physical web service returns a ranking. I think the ranking's still evolving. But Google has signaled that it will make a difference, that they will treat highly ranked beacons better. And we'll see some more implications of beacons in a minute. So that just highlights those are the fields that are extracted from that return JSON and are used to generate notification. So this is the physical web model. The beacon advertises the URL. The mobile device queries the physical web service with the URL and some other information about the beacon. And the physical web service returns data, JSON with data from the that was previously scraped from the website pointed to by the URL. And then the website, the mobile device uses that JSON to do something. So this model has sort of these two steps where the mobile device uses the mobile device queries the physical web server to ask for information about a beacon, and the physical web server populates its database by going and querying the URL. And that has several implications. One is if you have rapidly changing data, Google isn't going to catch it. There's the lag time between when your site changes and when Google comes around and actually looks at it again. And so my TIDE data doesn't change very often. I think it only runs every 4 hours. But that could get out if the Google web, physical web service doesn't come around and scan my website quick enough, you'll have old TIDE data. So that leads to the question of why not let the beacon administrator just tell Google what the information is rather than waiting for Google to scan the website and extract it. And that's the nearby model. The nearby model is that the beacon administrator generates a nearby URI, a UUID, and then the administrator associates data with that UUID. It might include, I think the URL may be optional, but includes a title, a URL. There's no description, right? So previously, that second line that had all that information about the tides, that's not included in the nearby data that can be uploaded. And you could also include an Android intent.
So are the intents used to launch the Play Store?
Intent, yes. The intent is used to either launch an app or to launch the Play Store. Now, the other thing to think about is Google. I mean, Google wants to know what's in, Google wants to rank. And so the way it, that provides Google a motivation to require you to click on notifications. If you don't click on the notification, Google doesn't know that you thought that was important. And so my model where the notification should be useful in and of itself and it should give you tide times, Google doesn't like that because they have no way to rank it. They want you to click on that notification to get the tide times, which I find irritating because it kind of shoots a hole in my Del Mar use case. But I really think that the, and again, this I think is where you see the two conflicting views within Google, that they want to provide, and they've, the nearby people have explicitly said, it's I can't remember, I could go find the language, should go find the language, but just that the notification is an opportunity to allow you to do something, to click on it and get a web page, to click on it and get an app fired up, or click on it and be led to the Play Store and prompted to install an app. Because they really like those clicks, and that's what is driving their ranking metrics. Android intent. Yes, that's how you get, so the nearby model, again, it's limited because it has this less information, no description. It's more powerful because not only can you have a URL, you can have an intent, which allows you to do neat stuff within your, potentially. This is how the nearby service works. And so if you have a recent Android phone and go enable nearby under the Google settings, this will enable what I think is precisely described as the nearby feature of Google Play services. So when things are working, this is part of Google Play services. When they aren't working, it uses Chrome, and there was several months there when actually they screwed up Google Play services and said, okay, we'll disable it and we'll use Chrome, and so. Did I say moving target? Again, we've hit through all this. The mobile device uses the JSON data from the nearby server to either display a notification, load up a web page, start an app, or go to the Google Play Store. Google nearby service, I think the phrase was, is more tightly integrated with Google services. That's Google speak to say it's really complex. You have to make this work. You have to get familiar with a whole bunch of Google services. It's like you can imagine what happened at Google, right? You've got these Google people that are using Google services all the time. And so they just walk through their bookcase of Google services and said, oh, we'll use this to do this and this to this. And that means you have to learn every one of these services in order to make nearby work. So from what I've seen, people are using the Eddystone URL format. I haven't seen, though it doesn't mean it hasn't happened, but I haven't seen people that are making heavy use of the nearby service yet among Eddystone users. And it's only available under Android devices, so tough luck to all those iOS devices, though. Google won't pre-announce. Google is very careful about not pre-announcing new products, but they hint that something this year will be available under iOS that will support the nearby service. I've said this, hinted at this. I mean, in Android, the preferred method is that Eddystone frames are processed by Google Play Services, which is the preferred method, and go to settings, Google nearby. Chrome browser also works, and that was part of the demo. And there was a period, as I said, where Google screwed up Google Play Services, or the nearby people screwed up Google Play Services, and so they disabled it, because I forget why, and so then they enabled, and then for a while you couldn't get any notifications, and then they released a version of Chrome that would generate those notifications if Google Play Services wasn't there, and then they fixed Google Play Services. There's also a physical web app. Does that work under iOS? I know it works under... If you're playing with Eddystone, you should get the physical web app. And if you're really playing with beacons, Eddystone beacons, you should probably go download the source too. It seems to almost compile under current Android Studio. A couple of things I had to change, but not much. I forget what they were. Some closing observations. It looks like we're hitting attention span limits here, so I will make a few comments, open it up to questions, and then you can be really, really early to lunch. Google Beacons are getting a lot of buzz. They have initially gotten a lot of buzz. There was a Motley Fool article, however, within the last couple of weeks where that pretty much said it was focused on iBeacons, though it mentioned Eddystone. It said pretty much that you know, we've sort of gotten over the buzz of beacons. That the claim was that Apple's doesn't seem very interested in them. They're not releasing new features. I think they made the same claim of Google. I don't know if this is accurate. I don't know what Apple's doing. I know that Google does have developers, which means I think more than one. If you're really doing beacons, you should go get on the Eddystone mail list too. It's critical, partly because this stuff keeps changing, and partly because they'll give hints as to what's coming, and a lot of it is just, how come I can't see any beacons? And the standard Google answer is, well, you're supposed to. Never mind that my phone at times will not see beacons at all. I've heard various claims that there's problems with the Bluetooth driver and so on and so forth, but at least one of my phones may not see beacons. But you know, I've got so much stuff on my phone, but other people have complained about it, and the standard Google answer is, well, no, it's supposed to work, or it does work, or something. Anyway, so a lot of buzz. I think the buzz has died down, but Google seems still committed to Eddystone. They have developers working on it. They're continuing to release stuff. They're continuing to try to make it work under iOS. I haven't seen any interest on Apple, though I don't track Apple, in making iBeacon work on Android phone. Again, I think their answer is just, well, buy an iPhone. I don't think the killer application for beacons has been found yet. Lots of interest in retail, because if you can figure out how to use them with retail, it's a big win and worth a lot of money. And lots of retailers are experimenting with the beacons and have developers that are playing with the beacons, and some local development organizations are playing with beacons. A lot of people are playing with beacons. Next time you go to a development shop, turn on your phone and see if you see any beacons, because you'll be surprised at who has beacons running. Not that you should engage in industrial espionage, but hey, if it's there, may as well listen. And I don't think we really understand what to do with beacons. What do we do about avoiding beacon spam? Should they launch apps? I think that using beacons with apps makes a lot of sense, and that's probably what we'll see. But maybe there's some new models with human interaction that haven't been developed yet. And there's no de facto standard for beacon protocols. I think that's been apparent throughout this presentation, right? Google has Eddystone, Apple has iBeacon, and there's a bunch of vendor-specific beacons, protocols. There's a ton of management protocols. Every beacon vendor has their own management protocol, neither Eddystone or iBeacon are supported well on both iOS and Android. And the answer, I think, is probably that beacons will have to advertise both Eddystone and iBeacon advertising frames. And I thought, though again, I don't have the agreement, I thought that originally Apple was telling beacon vendors that they could not announce iBeacon frames and other frames at the same time, but that must have changed. And people now do it. I assume the agreement changed, or maybe they're just ignoring it, or who knows what. So there's still no winner in the protocol, in the beacon protocol wars. And Google's beacon offerings continue to evolve. Google's trying to figure out what's a good model for human interaction. They've got this tension between what the physical web model and what I think is a separate physical web group and versus the nearby model. And I've hinted at what's the purpose of notifications? Is it to provide useful information? The answer from Google seems to be no. It's really there just to solicit user action. When I started working on stuff, this was the notification I could get in December. I think it was generated by the physical web app. Now you get this notification that is the nearby notification, which just gives you this more terse information, the title, and doesn't give the really important stuff. Instead, it just says, "Oh, click here to open the web page and up our rating counter." In our server, beacons I think have a lot of potential, but you got to do something about this Apple versus Google stuff. You as a beacon owner have to do something about it. Either the vendors will solve that for you and one protocol will win out, or you've got to just configure every beacon to announce both. And beacons are temperamental. I mean, RF is radio frequency stuff is involved, and anybody who's played with RF knows that things are temperamental. Like I say, I've never tried it, but you could probably take a beacon and rotate it, and its distance would vary. In other words, its antenna would work better in some directions rather than others. If you if you have a crowd full of people and have these at desk level, the people probably attenuate the beacon. MVP, my favorite or not so favorite acronym, minimal viable product. I mean, everybody's in a hurry to get to market, and so they're pushing out stuff that is minimal viable product, or almost minimal viable product. A lot of this stuff is just not real reliable. It's getting reliable. But still, you're seeing new releases of software from Google regularly. The beacon vendors have new software. And it's not always right. Oh, and continuous software updates and featuring in enhancements. The usual difference between documentation and the code exists in beacons just like everybody else. I think they have potential. I think we're still experimenting as to how that potential ought to be best realized. I mean, beacons, in my view, really do have to mature and stabilize. The beacons are a bit of a moving target, and that increases the risk of investing in beacons. I had a proposal that was not funded that was based on that idea of the opening, the model of that opening notification where you had a whole line of information. And once that went away, that kind of torpedoed my proposal, which wasn't accepted anyway. But still, it does increase the risk of investment, given that this is still a moving target. And it increases the risk of technology selection. You head down the path of Eddystone, URL format frames or Eddystone UUID frames or iBeacon or some other vendor. I mean, those seem to be the choices of the moment. I think that using some of the other beacon protocols is a higher risk, but it still increased risk, just the fact that things are sort of unstable. On the other hand, they do have a lot of potential, and I do think it's important for a lot of organizations, big retailers and others, to develop some expertise now and play with beacons and have some field trials to get an understanding of how they work. Because they aren't taking over the world today, but when they do take over the world, you want to be ready and have made some investment in them at that point. So, other questions? I'm happy to answer questions. Otherwise, you can get the lunch line's probably not even open yet. But you'll be there first.
More of an observation with iOS. Probably why the demo doesn't work reliably is because I think you mentioned you had your advertisements at like 950 milliseconds. So if you crank that down to Apple's recommended 100 milliseconds, it'll work much, much more reliably because Apple is scanning in a low power mode to conserve battery, and Android is probably just chewing through, scanning as hard as they can, which is why you'd see it more often on a Chrome.
That could, I mean, you're right. I have one I/O device which I won in a drawing, and which I pull out to do this presentation. So I don't see how reliable they aren't under iOS. But yes, Apple has a low power scanning mode. I'm not sure exactly what that means physically.
Means they don't let the developers pick it.
Well. And Google talks about a low power scanning mode, but yes, the way that Nearby works is when you pull, and you can see it, when you pull down your notification drawer, it starts scanning, and so you can see a lag there between when the notification drawer hits the bottom and when the Eddystone notifications appear. And yeah, they make some noise. Google makes some noise about how we're trying to figure out something or other. Eddystone does not scan continuously. So if you passed a beacon a while back, it's gone forever. There's no memory. There's no continuous scanning.
To go up, there's a recommended advertisement period for Eddystone.
Oh.
Do you know if there's a record?
I have the microphone, so I have to repeat. I have to repeat the question. I was prompted at that at the beginning of the presentation. I still forgot. Is there a recommended advertising? I forget. I think so. If you look in the spec, the spec is, as far as I'm concerned, the Eddystone spec you can go look at. It's not a tight spec. If you've looked at specs. Mine are set for, I think, 950 milliseconds, and I forget whether there might be some vague recommendation in vaguely those ranges, but I don't remember the exact language of the spec. But I have poked at Google. You know, spec writing is a tough business. To write a spec that ensures that anybody who follows that spec interoperates, and I don't think the Eddystone spec is there yet. But it's unlike Apple; you can at least read it without a non-disclosure agreement. More comments, more questions, more observations, more complaints. If not, I'll let you all go. Thank you for your attention, and these will be up on my website soon. If you're interested, I have cards here if you want to take one, and then you can go look at my website, and within the next few days this will be up if you want copies of the presentation, or you can send email and I can email the presentation to you. Okay, thanks so much.